You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support this show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Monday, August 13th, 2018. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, Cornell Professor of Government Suzanne Mettler on the government-citizen disconnect. Also on the program today, the massive Southern California holy fire arson suspect turns out to be a sovereign citizen. Meanwhile, the FCC's lies to Congress go unpunished. We'll have a better sense after Thursday's Senate hearing. Turkey crushed by Trump's tariffs. Question now is, will its financial crisis spread? And good news, we have a voting system so safe, only an 11-year-old can hack it. And your weekly, if not daily, reminder that ICE is a terror organization. The ACLU charges ICE with purposely preventing parents from contacting their kids. And Omarosa gets her revenge for her firing. The question is, when do we get ours for her hiring? Mick Mulvaney proudly announces a massive suite of pro-predatory lending and swindling policies. And Unite the Right falls flat as counter-protesters win the day big time. Meanwhile, a new poll shows Democrats view socialism more positively than capitalism. Jamie just had a heart attack. All that and more on today's program. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, it is another Monday. And as such, we will start our week of media cavalcades. Matt is on vacation. Brendan is on the board today. Michael, not sure what the deal is, but we will endeavor to persevere. We are short-staffed, but that has never stopped us in the past. I mean, that's not true. It has stopped us in the past, but it shan't today. Folks, just a reminder. One of our sponsors is BetterHelp.com. It is affordable, private, online counseling. You get unlimited access to a licensed, trained, fully accredited therapist that is perfect for you. You can do it on your phone, on your computer, through text, voice, or video chat. Is there anybody in this office who has not seen a therapist?
I've never seen a therapist.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
That to me is weird. I mean, I find that weird.
Yeah.
But, all right. What a perfect life you've led. No emotional issues, Brendan.
I have been pretty lucky.
Must be nice.
Yeah, really.
I'm the only one. I mean, my parents are still together. I'm white, upper middle class. You know, things
and
are
you,
pretty
you don't
good
have
for me.
Any, like emotional...
Well, I told you about that camp I went to up in the Berkshires. It was basically like, you know... a detox center for, like, not literal, but, you know.
So you had all that...
yeah.
All right.
There was, like, a community of that kind.
All right.
In my life.
You know...
Support system.
I did not try therapy until recently when I was at sort of a crossroads in my life, if you will, and I've found it very helpful.
Very helpful. It's very helpful, Brendan. We'll see. It all comes out. Maybe you're too young. It all comes out a little bit later. The thing about BetterHelp.com, they're LGBT friendly, great for couples counseling. anything else you're going through in life right now. All you need to do is go to betterhelp.com/majority. You fill out a questionnaire. They match you with a counselor who's perfect for you, and you start counseling today. If you end up feeling like this is not the right therapist for me, you can switch whenever you want. It's less expensive than in-person counseling, but you're still getting great help from licensed professionals. And if you have any trouble affording it, BetterHelp has financial aid available. The other thing about BetterHelp is you're always connected to your counselor. You have basically unlimited access, which means you can talk to them every single day if you want. Like I say, you can connect from anywhere, on your computer, at home, at work, on the go, on your phone. A lot of people are not comfortable talking to a therapist in person, or you don't have the time, or you can't afford it. BetterHelp solves all of these problems. You can sign up right now. Save on quality professional therapy by going to betterhelp.com/majority. All right, let's get into this. Omarosa. I mean, do I need to explain who Omarosa is? She was a contestant on The Apprentice. Then I think she won or came in second or something on her round and got hired into Trump Inc. And, of course, she was brought into the White House to function as a person in the White House. What was her job?
Her job was outreach to African-American communities.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah. I'm sorry. Apologize. Outreach to African-American communities. Okay.
Where's my African-American?
I mean, maybe she had a lot of experience at that. I don't know. But nevertheless, she was then fired at one point. And it turns out she realized, like, I should record things. And here is, she's got recordings of John Kelly firing her. We'll talk about that in a bit. But here is a recording of Omarosa that Omarosa made. Apparently, she called Donald Trump after she was fired by John Kelly. And this is the exchange.
An outrage. She was fired by Chief of Staff John Kelly last December in a meeting in the Situation Room that she recorded. Well, now Omarosa is providing NBC News with a new exclusive excerpt of a phone call she says she received from the president the day after her firing.
Omarosa, what's going on? I just saw in the news that you're thinking about leaving. What happened?
General Kelly came to me and said that you guys wanted me to leave.
No, I, nobody even told me about it. Nobody, wow. You know, they run a big operation, but I didn't know it. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
God, damn it. I don't love you leaving at all.
Well, Omarosa is now out with a new book. It's called Unhinged.
It all right. We don't even need to hear any more about her, Unhinged. I can only imagine who that was referring to in that White House. But what a coward.
Yeah.
What an extraordinary coward Donald Trump is. What? I didn't know about that. I had no idea. In fact, I didn't even know that you were fired now that I called you. Wow, this is news to me.
Yeah, imagine being so concerned with how much people like you that you decide that you're rather look completely incompetent at your job as commander in chief.
But do you think that's someone. What it is? It's just a word or he's just afraid of like conflict.
That too.
Like conflict, like face-to-face conflict or phone-to-phone conflict.
Yeah, so much for his catchphrase, right?
You're fired. Right. No, he's just like, it turns out it's a question mark.
Wow.
You're fired? I had no idea.
I know you're joking right now, but it still like struck a primal note of fear in my heart when I saw you say that at me.
Really? Well, you have nothing to worry about. So that is Donald Trump. That is Donald Trump, of course, being too afraid to fire. And we've heard this report. It was, who was it? The former VA head, Shulkin said the same thing, that there was an expectation, like Trump called him, talked to him about stuff and didn't realize that he was trying to get fired. He couldn't get fired.
Not that we want to bring up this man's name, but James Comey too, out west in LA,
right,
when he saw the TV.
Unbelievable. So that is just the way that Donald Trump rolls. He fires Omarosa without apparently or pretending to know that she's been fired and is really beside himself. What's that? Michael? No, Michael is not here today. I'm just getting someone's IMing me something. Michael's released the tape.
What?
That's weird.
Did they send it to you?
I'm going to send this over to you, right, Brendan. Apparently, Michael, who's not in today, released a tape on... Huh. All right. Well, Brendan, play this. It's weird.
Sure. One sec.
Hey, Sam, good morning.
Oh, Michael. Hey, what's this? I'm reading on Twitter or something. You're not coming in. You want to not come in or something? What is it?
Oh, no. I do. But Brendan actually pulled me aside the other day. He told me that I shouldn't come in anymore.
But really? Wow.
Yeah.
The operation's gotten so big now, I can't... Oh, really? God, I'm really sorry to hear that. Damn it. Darn it. Oh, Michael, well, listen, if I get a chance to talk to him, if I run into him around here, maybe in the commissary or something, but I'll look into that. I'm really sorry to hear that, but it was really... It was great to know you, but good luck. Oh, that was... phone call, I guess. I didn't realize that Michael was taping that. So, Brendan, what happened? Well, we'll talk about it later.
We'll talk about it in the fun half.
Yeah, I know.
It's a new show around here this week, folks.
There you go, folks. A lot of stuff happens around here that I'm not even aware of. We got to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to be talking to Suzanne Mettler on the government citizen disconnect.
The stories have been told of kings in days of old, but there's no England now. All the wars that were won or lost somehow don't seem to matter very much anymore. All the lies we were told, all the lives of the people running round their castles are burned. I see change, but inside we're the same as we ever were. Living on a thin line, ooh, tell me now.
Okay, we are back. On the phone, it is a pleasure to welcome to the program Professor of Government at Cornell University, author of The Government Citizen Disconnect, Suzanne Mettler. Welcome to the program.
Great, thank you. I'm delighted to be here.
Okay, let's now we last time we spoke, I think was for at least on this program was for your book entitled The Submerged State, which similarly themed in terms of people's relationship to government, both in terms of like their perspective of government and their sort of material relationship with government. Just tell us first what the study that the Government Citizen Disconnect is based upon.
Right. Well, when I wrote the book, The Submerged State, I was looking particularly at public policies that people use that are in the tax code. So, for example, the home mortgage interest deduction and various social benefits through the tax code, and finding that people were just very unaware of those being social policies. But in this book, The Government Citizen Disconnect, I took a broader look at the American welfare state generally. I looked at some, you know, over 20 public policies that people use. Some of them are in the tax code, but most of them are not. Most of them are things that we think of, from Social Security to unemployment insurance to Medicaid, food stamps, et cetera. And I wanted to get a bird's eye view of who uses these policies and how many policies people are using, and then how that relates to people's attitudes about government broadly understood. So that's what I was up to.
Well, you don't have to list all 21, but what, how obscure do are some of these programs that impact people?
You know, the 21 policies are not obscure. There are, longer lists of policies that, you know, various data sets look at that are pretty obscure. But I think that most Americans would recognize a lot of these policies as ones that either they themselves have used or they know someone who's used these policies. So, we're thinking of things that range from student loans to Pell Grants to the policies in the tax code that help people to afford going to college. For healthcare, it's Medicare and Medicaid, and employer-provided tax-exempt benefits. Those are a public policy because people don't have to pay taxes on them. Government subsidizes them, and retirement benefits such as Social Security, food aid in terms of the SNAP program, what we used to call food stamps, unemployment insurance, and so on.
Okay. And tell us about how you've been tracking those for a long time, and you there was, I guess, an element about the size of these that surprised you when you returned to them. And of course, that sort of lays the first foundation or building block of this sort of large paradox that really is at the heart of what you call the government citizen disconnect.
That's right. Yeah. So, I've been tracking the use of these policies historically. I came across an interesting data set from the federal government, from the Bureau of Economic Analysis, that looks at really just the more visible policies. It doesn't even include the ones that I call the submerged state. And if you look at Americans, the percentage of the average person's income that comes from these federal social benefits over time, it's grown dramatically. So if you go back to 1969, 7% of the average American's income came from federal social transfers or benefits. Now, most recently in 2014, it's up to 17%. And it's been a gradual increase over time. And of course, what that percentage is varies from place to place, from state to state, from county to county. But it's grown everywhere. And I was really fascinated to see this. I mean, if you delve in at the county level, you'll find that, of course, it's highest at some places like Appalachia, counties in Kentucky, for example, that were using it at higher rates way back when, but they're using a lot more now. But it's also increased in the wealthiest counties in the country. And so however you look at federal social benefits, the extent to which Americans rely upon them has increased dramatically all over the country and in individuals' lives. And I found this to be true when you look at Americans in all sorts of different ways, by what party affiliation they have, by what income group they're part of, and so on. But the paradox is that at the same time, people's attitudes about government have become much worse. Most Americans back in the middle of the 20th century had pretty favorable views about government in terms of they trusted in government. They felt government was responsive to people like them. And those attitudes have deteriorated over the past several decades. So the puzzle to me is, how can these two things go together? That people are both distrusting government, they're not confident in it, and yet they rely upon it more than ever for their everyday lives and for health and education, retirement, et cetera.
Now, is it basically these changes that have occurred in terms of both the increased reliance on government support and the growing, I guess, distrust of government? I mean, and we haven't quite established necessarily that they're related. I mean, they could be, but one would, I guess it's counterintuitive. One would assume that your perspective of government, the more you rely on it, would go up. There's no, across all different cohorts, is it more or less the same, the trajectory of both those phenomena?
Across different cohorts,
In other words, like for there's no difference in terms of class. There's no difference in terms of race,
right,
in terms of gender.
Right. I did all sorts of analysis to look at this, and yeah, it is the case that Americans generally have now much worse attitudes about government than they used to. I mean, now it's only about one in five Americans who will say that they trust the government to do, they trust federal government in Washington to do what is right most of the time, and that they feel government is responsive to people like them and so on. It used to be well over 60% or 70% on these different indicators. And so that's really widespread. But when I look at what causes these low levels of confidence in government, what I found is that people's public policy usage does not have much to do with it. So, you know, I would have thought going in that it would, that if people were relying more on government, that it would give them more positive views about it. And it really doesn't make much difference. If people are using policies in the tax code, it does not even make a dent on their views about government. If they're using policies where government's role is more apparent, for those who use means-tested policies, they are appreciative of government's role, and on some indicators, such as government has helped me in times of need, or government has provided opportunities for me to improve my standard of living, those individuals who've used more of those types of policies do have more favorable views of government. But aside from that, use of these policies makes very little difference. So then the question is, what does affect people's attitudes about government? And what I found, I looked at this in all sorts of different ways, and I controlled for all kinds of different factors. There was one thing that was highly significant again and again. And what that was people's attitudes about welfare. So people who have very unfavorable views of welfare, whatever that means to them, have in turn very negative attitudes about government. And it was very clear and very consistent. And let me just say that, you know, this is sort of striking to me as a scholar of social policy to begin with, because what we used to call welfare was one program, and that was aid to families with dependent children.
Right.
And there was a big war against AFDC for decades, really, in the latter 20th century, and it was finally terminated in 1996. And it was replaced by a more restrictive program, temporary assistance to needy families. Today, less than 1% of the American public is using that program at any point in time. So it's a tiny number of people. I mean, the program was welfare as we knew it, to use a phrase Bill Clinton had used, is nearly gone. And yet, the American public today is still very anti-welfare, and it drives their views about government. So you know, what is that about? It seems that you could think of it as it's the boogeyman that people associate something with that's much broader, and they're attaching it to more programs. But what I found when I looked at what are the determinants of those views, who feels that way, who's so anti-government, and it's about, by the way, about 44% of the American public has unfavorable views of welfare. What I found was that there were two things going on. One is that there does seem to be a racial bias. Whites are much more likely than people of color to have negative views about welfare. But in addition to that, and that's actually many other scholars have found that to be the case past. But what I found in addition was that income group mattered a lot. So I divided up the people I was studying into all of these smaller groups. I found that all of the groups in the middle class had much more negative attitudes about welfare than people who were less well off than themselves. And people who were higher income did not have significantly different views than low-income people on welfare either. So it was really the middle-income groups.
Can you give us a sense?
People in households from $35,000 to $100,000, very negative attitudes about welfare.
What accounts for that?
What's going on there? Well, what I think is that for middle-income people, the past several decades have been difficult times where they have seen declining opportunities. They're working harder than ever. We know that Americans' productivity is very high, and yet there have been stagnating wages for individuals in the middle class throughout those decades, and they have not felt that government is really being responsive to them. And so you have more and more people getting across those decades who were getting jobs that did not come with benefits, didn't come with health care, for example. College tuition for their kids was becoming more difficult to afford, and government was doing less to help them afford it, and so on. So I think, it's not surprising that people would feel more resentful. But the dynamic that's happening there is that people are, in a sense, blaming those who are worse off than themselves, thinking of them as undeserving. Some people in interviews that we did for the project told us that they felt that when they'd gotten into a slightly higher income group, then they no longer qualified for some benefits that they had when they were lower income. And so they were resentful about that. I think you have this combination of dynamics going on that have to do with both income as well as race.
Has that been consistent?
And then what's striking is that it determines not only attitudes about welfare, but in turn that shapes broader views about government.
Right. I mean, that is, has that level of resentment about welfare? Maybe not that it turns into resentment of government, but has that dynamic of resentment about welfare, has that been fairly consistent? I mean, there's so many, the tough part about this, right, is that all of these phenomena in some way line up. We've had 40 some odd years of 45 maybe now, some odd mm-hmm. years of declining wages, of declining unionism, right. Of an increase in maybe reliance on government. But also, just coincidentally, 45 years ago was basically when we had the Civil Rights Act and we had the Voting Rights Act. And there was sort of a realignment of parties. And so it's hard to disaggregate all these things, isn't it?
Right. Yeah, that's true. And I would love to be able to answer your question about, you know, do these welfare attitudes, have they been consistent over time? And I don't know the answer to that. In fact, it's something I'm planning to look at, but I don't yet know.
Okay, well, good. That will give us another reason to talk in the future. But what is clear is that we have seen these, at the very least, fairly consistency over the past couple of decades. We've seen a side eye towards welfare, which really, in some respects, doesn't exist in the way that people presume it does. And that right. is a means or a vehicle to for growing mistrust of government. I mean, I think, like, you know, from my perspective, there is at least one party that has been sort of actively driving that. Right. I mean, Ronald Reagan was talking about the welfare queen. And
that's right.
OK, so with that being the case, that growing, what's fascinating about your work here is that growing resentment comes almost in inverse proportion in some respects to how much these same people are probably relying on government themselves.
Yes, exactly. That's right.
All right. Well, so tell us about the theory of policy feedback and how that is implicated in this.
Yeah. So policy feedback is a term that political scientists use. And what we mean is that policies, once they're created, can have effects that were never planned or intended by policymakers that reshape politics. So, for example, Andrea Campbell at MIT did a wonderful study of Social Security and Medicare. And, of course, the goal of it was to provide, the goal of Social Security was to provide for initially just for retirement of people who were beneficiaries. But she found that it also had political consequences, that those senior citizens in turn became more politically active. And they were becoming active in order to protect their benefits. And so that was a policy feedback dynamic, right? That's a sort of a classic example of it. So I wondered in doing this study, whether policies would also shape people's attitudes about government more broadly. And what I found in a nutshell is not really. They don't seem to have much impact on people's broader attitudes about government. I think that's because people don't necessarily connect those dots. They don't think, oh, here I am, you know, with a substantial part of my income coming from these government policies. Therefore, it must be that public officials actually are trying to represent people like me and so on. People don't make those connections unless someone helps them to do so. Some organization that they're part of, such as the AARP or labor unions, for example. And there's much less of that happening than existed in the past. So I don't really find that kind of policy feedback dynamic. So the irony is that over these many decades, as you were saying, conservatives have been on a war against the welfare state really since around 1980. And they have not succeeded. I mean, this is very interesting. I mean, there's only one major program that was decimated, and that was, as I said, AFGC. But at the same time, people's attitudes about government broadly have been undermined over these same time periods. And I don't think that was conservatives' initial goal. So, you know, we're now at a point in time where people are extremely skeptical of any kind of activity that government engages in even though they're still using all of these policies of the welfare state. So it's a paradoxical outcome.
Okay. A couple of things. Let me just start with let me go backwards. In terms of that being the conservatives' goal, I mean, if it wasn't their goal, it feels like they certainly have embraced that that perspective of just broadly attacking the idea of government, right? I mean, even, you know, I'm just thinking of, again, Reagan, you know, when the, you know, the government is an obstacle, right? I mean, it's the way that they provide an assault on the regulatory state. But this, you're suggesting that this was a twofer for them, attack welfare and also undermine people's perspective on government.
I think that conservatives wanted to scale back the welfare state. And I think that, you know, you're right. They also wanted to scale back regulatory policies. I don't think that they wanted people to move to fundamental distrust of anything that government does and to move to a point where, you know, they're questioning basic principles of American government and norms that have been longstanding norms about how government operates in the United States, about civil liberties and civil rights, about freedom of the press, et cetera.
All right.
So I think it got somewhat out of hand.
All right. I mean, I would agree with that. I don't think is necessarily material to what we're talking about, because I'm a little bit more jaundiced about that. But putting that aside for a moment, I'm also really interested in this dynamic of Social Security had elderly people more invested in politics and in, you know, in government, and it activated them. And and you suggested this was a function of maybe like an organization like AARP that gave them sort of an outlet to do this, and that unions served a similar function, because it is, you know, well established that folks who receive, let's say, Medicaid tend not to be politically engaged. And I wonder if the explanation of this is not just that elderly folks or, you know, retired folks had the AARP, and that unions had the, you know, union members had the union, but that also Medicaid, people who receive Medicaid by and large are still under a tremendous amount of financial anxiety, pressure, deprivation, versus someone in a union or someone who is getting Social Security, because the Social Security actually, you know, relative to what's on your plate, Social Security takes care of you, you know, gives you a baseline that you can't fall through. Whereas something like Medicaid, let's say, or even, you know, the temporary assistance TANF that we now have is, it seems to me to be a lot less, you know, provide you a lot less room to get politically active. You still have a tremendous amount to do to make sure that your kids eat or that you have a roof to live over. I mean, could it simply be not just a function of having a mechanism to express political, activity, but also just like that's a certain, not quite a luxury, but it's like,
yeah. Yes. No, you're absolutely right. So, you know, I was mentioning that people who use many of these means tested visible policies like Medicaid, for example, food stamps, et cetera, tend to be quite appreciative of them. And I also found that those same individuals are in favor of more expanded social benefits for the population generally. But here's the rub. They actually participate less in politics. They're much less likely to vote, and they're much less likely to participate in all kinds of other activities than people who have used other kinds of policies. And what does that relate to? It relates to the fact that, as you're saying, their lives are really complicated, and they, you know, for all of the political scientists have a, you know, large, longstanding literature about who participates in politics and who participates less. And there are several factors that work against the activity of those individuals. The fact that they're likely to be very poor, and to have very little leisure time, et cetera. So it's not surprising that they participate less. But what this means, I found, is that there is a participatory tilt. The people who participate most in politics are those who, they do use social benefits, just like all other Americans. All Americans are using plenty of social benefits. But the people who participate most tend to use ones that they're least aware of, policies that are hidden in the tax code, like the home mortgage interest deduction and so on. And so they are less likely to be participating and thinking about government as being a useful and positive force in society. They're more likely to have anti-government attitudes.
Right, because on some level, the support that they're getting from the government allows them to, you know, it allows them almost like the luxury side of their life. Right. Like, you know, if you get a big mortgage deduction on a massive house, if you're 529 now, you can save money for your private school without yes, taxes. I mean, this is a perfect example of just like you're getting upgraded to business or first class because of government support, as opposed to it's just getting you on the plane in economy.
That's right. And, you know, let me clarify that if a lot of people were listening right now, whether say, and they themselves are using those policies, the reaction that many people have is, wait a minute, you know, that's my own money. And that means that government is taking less of my money than it would otherwise, you know, if these policies are in the tax code. What I want to point out is that they are social benefits, just like the more visible type. So take, for example, how we deal with housing. For a low-income person, we provide housing subsidies. For a person who can afford a house with a mortgage, we allow them to pay less in taxes. From an accounting perspective, it doesn't matter whether we're sending someone a check or whether we are allowing them to pay less in taxes. Either way, there's less money in the federal treasury. Or think of it as, you know, people of the same income group, and one of them rents and the other one has a house with a mortgage. We give the benefit to the person with a house with a mortgage. We give nothing to the person who's renting. And so it is a special benefit that we're giving to those individuals. But because of the way it's delivered through the tax code, people don't see it as much.
That's right. I mean, the government is picking winners and losers in this situation.
Exactly.
And,
that's right.
And so let's talk about you focus on you do a little bit of geographic focusing and a little bit of, in terms of policy. I mean, briefly, let's talk about Kentucky and then the earned income tax credit. I mean, we've covered some of this stuff, but Kentucky is a particularly interesting case that you look at.
It is, yeah. So Kentucky is a poor state. There's a lot of poverty there, and there long has been. If you go back to 1970, 10% of the average Kentuckian's income came from federal social transfers. And by 2015, that was up to 23%. But at the same time, things changed politically in Kentucky. So Kentucky used to send mostly Democrats to Congress. And most of them were moderate Democrats, and some of them on social policies were quite progressive. For example, Carl Perkins came from Kentucky and was the champion of a major higher education policy that helped low-income students. By the time we get to the early 1990s, Kentucky was changing and beginning to send moderate Republicans to Congress. And then by the mid-1990s to the present, those Republicans became more and more conservative, members of the Freedom Caucus over time. And so you have now members from Kentucky who are saying, you know, we should have work requirements on food stamps. And yet a very high percentage of their own constituents are using these same public policies. So it's really, it sort of illustrates that paradox.
And again, is that a function of the the folks who are using at least a big chunk of those services are just not active in terms of politics, and the ones who are using the sort of the high end benefits are.
That participatory tilt is part of the explanation. But then it's also the case that, you know, I was saying that today we don't really have organizations and political leaders who are effectively connecting the dots for people about their use of policies and what government's doing for them. But other folks are connecting dots for people in Kentucky, and the dots they're connecting are they're saying, you know, these environmental policies that Democrats have been promoting, that's the reason why the economy is doing badly in Kentucky. That's why we're losing jobs in coal mining, for example. Now, you know, if you drill down, there's not good evidence for those claims. Coal mining jobs have been leaving Kentucky since, middle of the 20th century for all sorts of reasons that don't have to do with public policy. But that story that conservatives have been telling has convinced people. And so they vote accordingly, and they're more focused on those issues than on social benefits.
All right. So earned income credit. Just explain to people what that is, because I'm not sure that people fully understand this policy. And we should say this is a policy that was pushed back when there was some broad agreement that we should try and provide a social safety net. The earned income tax credit was sort of the Republican favored way of providing that safety net.
Yeah, both Republicans and conservative Democrats really championed the earned income tax credit really beginning in the 1970s onward, and it became expanded during the Clinton years and more recently. And this is today our most effective anti-poverty policy that we have in the United States. And it's channeled through the tax code. And it's for people who could be called the working poor. They work, but they make very low wages. And so government supplements that with extra funds that people receive when they file their taxes. So it's very effective from a social and economic point of view, but I wanted to know what impact it had politically on people's attitudes about government. And what I found is that it really doesn't make a dent, that people who receive it, they don't think of government as doing anything for them. In fact, these tend to be individuals who have very negative attitudes about government. And, you know, probably for a lot of reasons that are not surprising, life has been hard for them and they don't feel that government has helped much. But when they receive the EITC, they tend to experience it as coming from their own work effort. And this is even if they have no tax liability themselves, they don't see government giving them something. It's also a matter of how it's delivered. So a lot of people, in order to claim the EITC, they go to H&R Block, for example, which fills out their forms for them and files them, and then they get the benefit. They like it that they don't have to go to a welfare office to receive these benefits. And yet what that means is, because they're not going to some kind of a government office, that government's role is just invisible.
So, explain to people how this is calculated. So, like, for instance, if you are a single worker, you're making about $45,000 a year. Let's say you have two children. You're going to get back, about $5,000 or $6,000, right? I mean, maybe, I don't know, 11%, 12%.
Yeah.
What is that money represent? I mean, how do they determine that? Is that just a function of like money that you have paid in terms of like payroll taxes, or that they just going to give you back, or what is that exactly? Or is that money that you never paid in taxes?
So it's calculated on the basis of how much the individual has been earning and how many dependents they have, for some people, they have been paying some income taxes, and then they're getting money back on top of that. For some individuals, they actually owe nothing because they're low enough income, and they get a check from government, which is the EITC. So they have no tax liability, and they're still getting, and they're getting a benefit.
So just to be clear, these are people who, in Mitt Romney's words, right, when he's in his secret fundraising meetings, these are the 47% of takers. The vast majority of these people are those people. And yet they don't see themselves as those people.
I have trouble answering that question because Romney was wrong in so many ways with the 47%
right,
comment.
Right, right.
But the larger point you're making is correct, right? Though I would point out that, you know, everyone is paying Social Security taxes if
right.
they're working. So even if they're not paying federal income taxes, they're paying FICA.
Right. That's where they go to once you ask them, once you get specific with them about that question. All right. Well, so with all this said, and this is the dynamic laid out, what do we do? Like, I mean, this is not a good situation where that the policies that we have end up undercutting support for the policies that we have that help people?
Yeah, well, I mean, part of it is designing policies differently. But at the moment, you know, we're not about to do that because of all sorts of things that are going on in politics. But what we can do more quickly is begin to connect the dots for ourselves, for our families, for our organizations, for our communities. I mean, that's what conservatives have mastered, and they've been doing that over many decades. And I think that other people have kind of, you know, stopped doing it. And so that's where you have this disconnect in people's actual circumstances and the extent to which they rely on government social benefits and their views about government, because they're not connecting those dots about the extent to which they actually use various benefits. So I think that organizations need to do this with their members. I think we need to that people who are running for office and elected officials need to make much more of a point of talking about benefits in these specific kinds of ways. You know, we find that when Americans' attention is drawn to vague terms like about the size of government and taxes, and I would add to that list welfare. These are highly symbolic terms, and they immediately make Americans respond in ways where they seem quite conservative. But if you talk to people about specific policy benefits that lots of people have utilized, like unemployment insurance and Social Security and so on, people are very supportive of these programs. And so if we put more attention on these specific things that government does rather than on the vague terms about it, then I think you have very different responses.
What about if we have a world where we can actually refashion policy? I mean, I certainly, you know, I mean, I think we can go around and try and message what exists better. But you know, I keep thinking about that dynamic of why people protect Social Security more and why. And I can't help but think that it's because it provides enough for them that they can afford to actually engage in politics.
Yes, that is true. And low-income people who are Social Security beneficiaries are much more active in politics than we would predict on the basis of their income group. And you're right, because Social Security gives them the capacity to do that.
Is the answer essentially to, you know, when we get into a position where where policies could actually change, is to make things more universal and, frankly, more generous?
Well, you know, ideally, yes, we would make things more universal and more generous, but we can start out by making them more visible. so that people are at least aware of what government is already doing, and that it's coming from government, that it's not just coming from the private sector or from their own efforts. And so, you know, simple things about how policies are delivered can make that difference, I think.
Suzanne Mettler, the Government Citizen Disconnect. We will put a link to that at majority.fm. Thanks so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. I enjoyed chatting with you.
All right, folks, we're going to take a quick break. I'm going to turn the phone machine on. We're going to successfully land this. Brendan, how are you doing? Brendan looks like he's like, you want that betterhelp.com/majority for your counseling needs.
Yeah, I would have liked to have started that off a bit better, but, you know.
That's all right. That's the beauty of having a podcast is you can always clean that stuff up for, I mean, we have a lot of people who watch live.
Shout out to all the live viewers right now.
Yes. Thank you for rejoining us after last week. We were mistakenly, you know, it's unbelievable. You know, it's funny because there's obviously a big, you know, YouTube is cracking down a little bit. And I am fine with that. I'm glad they're cracking down on hate speech. And I'm okay that sometimes they make mistakes based upon, like, you know, a robot can't tell what is ironic and not ironic. And even when they do the manual check on it, sometimes it goes, I mean, we've had videos. We have a video, the interview that we did with, and her name escapes me, but she was a professor who wrote a book about the KKK in the 1920s. Linda Gordon, a high-end, frankly, interview about history in this country, completely demonetized. And I can understand it. If I'm an advertiser, I may not want to be, you know, you're hearing about the resurgence of the KKK in the 1920s. Like, if you actually listen to it, you realize, like, oh, no, that's not I'm perfectly happy to sponsoring this. But there is no operation where they're going to listen to a 45-minute interview and then make a sort of like broad, subjective decision that's just not worth it for them. And so these things happen. Fortunately, we work it out, and that's good. But, you know, like literally the next day, we, you know, someone signs me up for all of the, at Majority Reporters, for all of the worst sort of mailing lists. Ben Shapiro from Ben Shapiro Report. Over 80 of our videos are now restricted by YouTube. Now, I got news for you. These videos, I don't know if they're restricted. He probably means they're not monetized. Fellow American, for more than 2 years. Here, and actually, go find this in the Majority Reporters. Can you find it? You can put this up on the thing. For more than 2 years, YouTube has continued to restrict access to more and more of Prager University's educational videos simply because they present a conservative point of view. This is just absolutely, first of all, there is no restricted. That category does not exist on YouTube. There is monetized or taken down, or demonetized or taken down, right?
There's not like a YouTube After Dark or anything.
Exactly. Like, are you genuinely conservative? Because if you're not, you can't see this. You know, we're going to see your ID. More than double the amount of restricted videos since filing our lawsuit against YouTube. Silicon Valley giants like YouTube continue to censor the ideas they don't agree with. They promote their leftist ideology and restrict conservative speech. Help us fight against the censorship of our videos. From the beginning of this process, we prepared to pursue our lawsuit against Google, YouTube as far and as long as it takes to secure everybody's Americans' right to freedom of speech online. It's unbelievable, A, the way they harp about their inability to make money on YouTube. It's unbelievable how they will fight against net neutrality but we'll be okay. But I have a problem with YouTube saying we're not going to sell ads for your videos. It's shocking. Freedom of speech. And I happen to think like we should, you know, nationalize YouTube or break it up into a bunch of different pieces so that one entity cannot effectively shut you out of the conversation because they control the conversation. But this is not a freedom of speech issue. It just simply isn't. As we continue this important fight, not just for PragerU, but for freedom of speech in America, we need your money. We need your money. Blah, blah, blah. Can we count on your support? I mean, it's just a fundraiser, but it's just stunning to me. It's just stunning. They got this down so big time. And the other thing now that we're going to just mention, too, is that we got people have been telling me that CRTV, I guess that's what is that? Conservative? What is that? Conservative Real TV? I don't know what it is. With Gavin McGinnis, who apparently got banned from Twitter. I'm sorry about that.
Not the so ads, proud now.
The ads, exactly. The ads, take that with your Will Perry tennis shoes or whoever. What is it? What are the kind of...
Ben Sherman? Fred Perry?
Fred Perry shirts. They advertised during our show. And I've said this before. I'm very happy to take their money. But that is also why they do so well, is because they have funding to advertise across YouTube in a way that, you know, entities like ours don't. So, I mean, all of this, it's just, it's interesting. And we, it just came up because, of course, we got, we lost our streaming rights on last weekend, on Friday, but they're back. All is good. And thank you for your support. What we'll probably do, I don't know, we're going to look into backup streaming facilities and maybe ask people to try it out one day just so that they get comfortable with it in the event that something like that happens. Because, you know, YouTube is cracking down now to a certain extent. You know, I don't think it's going to be enough, but we'll see. All right, folks, just a reminder. In the meantime, you can support this program by becoming a member. Go to jointhemajorityreport.com. It is a couple of bucks a week. And as a way of saying thank you for supporting this day-in, day-out show, we give you extra content every day, and we send you good vibes. We have just installed a new good vibe machine, and it seems to be working quite well.
Yeah, no extra charge for the good vibes.
No, that is the way we say thank you. We get good vibes. Now, what we did do is we upgraded. We have more capacity for our good vibe machine now, and we got the higher frequency levels. So the vibes, you don't pick it up immediately. Over time, though, you get significantly gooder vibes.
Yeah, it's cumulative.
Cumulative, right. Aggregates. It actually, they've found some that stores in your pancreas. So become a member today at jointhemajorityreport.com. Also, don't forget justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY. Get 10% off. Jamie, this week on the Antifada.
Yes. So this week, we were fortunate enough to be joined. We had a rare appearance by Comrade Communicator, spokesperson of the Intergalactic Workers League, Posadist, to talk about Space Force.
I did not understand anything you just said.
Oh, well, that's why you got to listen. We talk about Space Force, terrestrial capitalism versus cosmic communism, forging an alliance with our class brothers and sisters of the sea, namely the dolphins, and overcoming exploitation and oppression through the intervention of extraterrestrial beings, or as Posadis refer to them, the space comrades.
There you go.
Also, we had so much good content from Matt and Virgil's appearance last week that we stitched together a little bonus for our patrons with some of the stuff that didn't make it into there.
Very nice. Very nice. And Brendan, you're just taking a learning annex class on the board.
Yeah, I'm getting baptized all week in the fires of the Majority Report tech scene.
There you go.
Tune in.
Going to take a quick break. We'll be right back. 646-257-3920 is the number if you want to be a part of the program. We will be playing some sound, and we will have some IMCU in the fun half.
Hey, so we take one. La poupée qu'il fait non.
Fuck off.
I give her my love, she says no. I give her my heart, she says no, no, no.